Well, good morning, everybody. This is what we've all been waiting for. It's the presidential address. I have the distinct privilege this morning to introduce the 53rd president of the American Pediatric Surgical Association, Dr. Edward Metz Barksdale, Jr. I've titled my introduction, The Making of an Absent President. In the beginning, God created Edward Metz Barksdale, Jr. And he endowed him with some key attributes that are only fit for a future president of APSA. So what are some of these attributes? Please look at his ability to make eye contact even as a toddler. Very, very important attribute to have if you're going to be president. And look at that infectious smile. I'm going to be everybody's friend. Everyone's going to vote for me. And then look at his overall countenance and demeanor. You know that the likability index is way off the chart. But then there were some other attributes that became evident as he grew older. He was self-confident. Look at that. Look at that pose, folks. Fashionable from the very beginning. And oh, by the way, he was dispassionate. It's very important that a leader be able to maintain equipoise, especially when you have to evaluate very difficult situations. And here we can see him being quite dispassionate, looking at his sister's graduation. But he was also very cool, with an afro, and quite intelligent. It was around the time in high school that we actually ended up meeting in the summer program in New York. He was, as I said, extremely brilliant, and he went to Yale University, where he continued his tradition of excellence. He was an All-American captain of the fencing team. He was a scholar athlete who almost went to the Olympics. Also played, also a great. A great tennis player. And when he was not playing tennis or fencing, he was exploring his keen research interests in ice cream sundaes. From Yale, he distinguished himself and went to Harvard Medical School. And this is where I had to coin the term the Barksdale enigma. So what do I mean by that? He tried to portray himself as this shy, quiet, reserved, and serious individual most of the time. But I ask you, was he simply calculating? Well, you be the judge. Here he is being really shy and reserved and holding court talking to everybody you know. And here he is being quite serious. And here he's not too calculating at all. And here he's preparing for an all-nighter studying anatomy and physiology in the Boston nightclubs. But in between, he was really a very studious and devoted and meticulous medical student who excelled at Harvard. And here he is at the time of his graduation, flanked by his father, Ed Barksdale Sr., and his sister, Linda. And please, look at the expression, still dispassionate. I just graduated from Harvard. What the heck? Nothing special. From there, he went to Mass General Hospital, where he matched in general surgery, and he continued to distinguish himself as an outstanding resident. He met and worked in the lab of Pat Donahoe, who became his mentor and sponsor in pediatric surgery. Not surprisingly, Ed was named a super chief resident. Here they made those two, Len Johnson, his partner, they made history because this was the very first time that Mass General named two black residents to be super chief. But look at the face, look at the expression. There's still something missing. He is not happy. That radiant smile is not as broad as we normally, as we've seen it in the past. There was a void. There was something missing in his life. Well, God smiled on him when Vivian Johnson, the scrub nurse for Andy Warshaw, decided to introduce him to her lovely daughter, Michelle. Well, look at that smile. It's back. It is back. And look at the eye contact, folks. The man is happy. The missing link has been found. And also, please, focus on Michelle's expressions. What the heck did I get myself into? Well, this beautiful union yielded four amazing children, Trey, Drew, Gil, and Morgan. They inherited their father's athletic genes, and they all were scholar athletes who played Division I sports in college. And they have a joie de vivre that's simply unparalleled. And here you can see they can't stand still at all. They just gotta get their feet off the ground. The Barksdales are a very, very close-knit family. And unfortunately, Trey had to head back last night because he's graduating from medical school tomorrow. But this great family is anchored by none other than the amazing Michelle. She's the backbone of that family. She keeps everybody straight. And she is his confidant, and I know that that's the person who is, I know that's the person that he relies on most heavily, and she's responsible for what he has become and for the entire family. But Michelle is really aided by an amazing village, and here you can see the Barksdale clan flanked by Michelle's parents, Stanley and Vivian, and also the rest of her family, and also Linda in that picture. But there are three other individuals who have played a pivotal role in this village. Ed's father, Edward Metz Barksdale Sr., and his mother, Georgia, and of course, his sister, Linda Woodruff. And here you see Ed Sr. and Georgia renewing their vows after 50 years of marriage, of course, flanked by all the grandchildren. I know that Ed Sr., Georgia, and Linda are smiling broadly from heaven this morning as they look down and contemplate the amazing fruit of their labor. Their son, their brother, has reached the pinnacle of American pediatric surgery. He's the president of APSA. It's hard to summarize the pedigree of an amazing man in just one slide, or even in 10 minutes. But I've just captured some of the key highlights right here. You've heard it. Yale University, All-American Fencer, Scholar, Harvard Medical School, Mass General, Chief Resident, Pediatric Surgery at Cincinnati, attending and professor at Children's Hospital of Pittsburgh, Surgeon-in-Chief at Rainbow Babies, and Bob Eisen Professor at Case Western, a prolific scholar whose current research focuses on youth violence prevention and recidivism. He's won multiple teaching awards, elected to academies of master educators, recognitions galore. He's an exemplary mentor, clinician, leader, and administrator. But for me, he is that friend that I met in the summer of 76, who became my brother at medical school, and whose friendship I've continued to cherish and depend on over the course of the last 46 years. And we never pass up on the chance to come together to compare notes wherever we go, especially during the surgical meetings. Here you see us as chief residents at the second Society of Black Academic Surgeons meeting in Boston. I managed to entice him and convince him to join me in Pittsburgh, where we spent truly 10 glorious years together as brothers. And when I left for Los Angeles and he left for Case, we continued to maintain the close ties. We continued to get together, although I would miss these Christmas dinners. Here we are at the AAP in 2008, and later at the Society of Black Academic Surgeons meeting in 2016, and Ed was the past president of SBAS. And more recently, at the American College of Surgeons meeting of the Board of Governors, where we'd always get together and flanked by past president Diana Farmer. Folks, towards the late 1990s, there were 10 black pediatric surgeons practicing in North America. It was Ed's idea that we come together and learn from the first African-American to practice pediatric surgery in the state, and the first one to be admitted to the surgical section of the AAP, and also the second one to be admitted to APSA, Dr. Densler. And there we learned about the importance of mentorship. But Ed took it to another level. he understood the importance of sponsorship and advocacy if we were going to make a dent in those numbers. And because of his effort, that number has more than quadrupled, so now we can count more than 45. It's not enough yet, because we do represent still no more than 3% of the total pediatric surgeon population, but that is part of the evolving legacy of Ed Barksdale. In summary, we know Ed is a great statesman whose eloquence is really unparalleled. He's brilliant. He's a great communicator who is as effective speaking to senators, governors, or janitors at the same time. He makes you feel that you're his friend. He's an amazing mentor, and he's a visionary leader who established the inaugural SBAS Leadership Workshop to help train the next generation of leaders in American surgery. Oh, he's a ladies' man. Everybody loves Ed. But I'm sorry, ladies, he only has eyes for Michelle. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct pleasure to present to the 53rd president of the American Pediatric Surgical Association, my friend, my brother, your president, Dr. Edward Barksdale.
Am I okay from a sound check perspective? I just want to say something and be respectful to everyone here with my next comment. Henri, you are a friend that is closer than a brother. Thank you. I would like to begin my talk today in the way that I begin my day, with a sense of gratefulness and gratitude and hope and hopefulness for the space and place that I reside and at the time that I live. As you know, I grew up in the South, and I grew up with this strong sense of hope, and I want to say thank you to you for this tremendous opportunity. But I would be remiss in expressing my gratitude, me, not Ed, that's Ricky, that's what my mother called me. And I love that picture because only I can see my mother standing in the back of the door, overlooking me, guiding my words, guiding my thoughts. Ricky, don't go across the street. Ricky, don't look at those people drinking over there. And in many ways, although she's not here physically with her, I feel her looking at me and overseeing me, and I'm thankful for her. You guys know what Abraham Lincoln said. I remember my mother's prayers, and they have followed me. They have clung to me my entire life. And so many of my friends say, don't say so much about your mother, because you had a father who was married to her for 63 years, and my father is the man I want to be. I am trying to be the man my mother tried to make me to be in his honor. And everything I am and everything I ever hope to be, I owe to that man. He's with me today as well. Too many quotes, too many aphorisms have guided my life. One of them from my grandmother is that the power of the wolf is in the pack, and the power of the pack is in the wolf. This is my wolf pack here, and I would be nothing without them. This is the closer group of that wolf pack. You see, for those of us who grew up in matriarchy, you see the powerful woman in that picture, I hope. She's the one in the light blue dress. My wife, Michelle, who hopefully you've had a chance to meet. She's my first leadership coach for Holly Neville. This is my coach, but I got another coach too, but she's also my peer support as well, Lauren. And here she is being crazy. She's humorous. Those of you who trained at the MGH know that we are an arranged marriage. My mother-in-law is there, and many of you know my mother-in-law. And I think she has made every moment of my life happy from the first day that I saw her. And even on cloudy days, she is the sunlight when the gray clouds kind of overtake. Noble and elite. Noble and elite. For me, that's what pediatric surgery has always been. My mother told me, do something that's noble and elite. And I'm not trying to be chauvinistic with the next slide, it's just my experience. But when I was at Harvard Medical School, and the first lecture I heard on the Friday before Monday classes was Judah Folkman, and I met this powerful surgeon who happened to be a woman who reminded me of the strength of my mother, Pat Donahoe, and there are many of us in this room who shared it, and then Hardy Hendren. And then there are some of you at Boston Children's who know Sonny Black, one of the first African-American pediatric surgeons. Well, I don't have to go through the names. These are faces who we all know, leaders within our organization. And then I went to Cincinnati, and there were icons of this field in Cincinnati, noble and elite. They were guides. And then, when I was in Boston, the Dans, who were the emerging Twin Towers when I was working in Pat Donahoe's lab. And so when you're around these people, you can't help get an idea of what you want to be. Mark Rowe, who gave me my first job. And then it wasn't always these people that I looked up to. It is the people that I looked to both sides. John Aiken, a tremendous surgeon and tremendous friend. Dan von Ullman, I think he's still here, outstanding individual. I had great times with my fellows. And Henri, as I say all the time, I knew him when he was Henry. He doesn't like me to say that. But I have believed strongly in my life that none of us achieves on our own. We all have some community or family that guides us, whether we're born into that family or not. And one of my fathers in pediatric surgery is James Densler. Dr. Densler, I hope you're watching. You told me you would be on. I pay great honor to you, the first African-American pediatric surgeon. And then my partners in Pittsburgh, we had a great time in the Berg, didn't we? Barb Gaines, you're here. This was a great place to be. And then how could I say anything more about the place that I am now? A wonderful group of partners and nurse practitioners. We call ourselves work family, and we try to function in that way. And then there are other nurses that I've worked with over the course of my career. I can't include all of them. I left out Jane Ann Jaworski, who I did short bowel syndrome with. But these are some of the nurses who have been important in my career. And I say thank you. I could not start without saying thank you. Today, I have some special guests with me, a friend, Paula Shaw, who's watching the live stream from the airport. And I have my executive coach, who is here. Thank you so much, Sandra, for coming. And so I'd like to reflect on our last meeting, the last meeting that I attended, which was in Boston, in which we introduced our kind of new logo, Saving Lifetimes. And we started thinking about what the future would look like in American pediatric surgery. You know, there's a quote, another quote, African-American quote I grew up with, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. And we in APSA have gone both fast and far in our first 50 years. But what do the next 50 years look like? And what does it really mean when we say we're saving lifetimes? Is that just a platitude, or is that something that we really embrace? So the topic that I'd like to speak quickly with you about, I got a gazillion slides, so it'll look a little bit like a slideshow. I would like to talk to you about noblesse oblige, advocacy, activism, and leadership. I have these objectives, but there are really four things that I hope to do. The first thing is I'd like to give you a bit of my life's narrative, so it helps frame what we're going to talk about. I want to talk to you about advocacy, activism, and leadership. I want to talk to you about my work, not my job. Your job is where you get paid, your work is where you add value. And finally, I'd like to have a call to action. Born and raised in this beautiful city at the foothills of the Blue Ridge Mountains, Lynchburg, Virginia. And although many people may not have heard of it, or many people may think in pejorative terms, but when I grew up there at the toward the end of the Jim Crow era, you guys know that time, that was when things were separate but equal. But some of us never saw that equality. But Lynchburg had the highest per capita millionaires of any city in the country. There was old Southern wealth. And by living in a place like that, I came to understand privilege and power. They told me where to live. They told us where we could eat. They even told us what water fountain we could drink from. My father was a postal worker who worked 3.5 hours away in order to get equal pay. My mother was a seamstress in a sock factory. She never graduated high school. But they raised us with a very strong sense of values. And this woman here is my grandma, Baba, who lived next door. She taught me about power. She taught me about privilege. She taught me about justice, and she taught me about hope. She was a social worker. And interestingly enough, as you may have heard me say the other day, she spoke German fluently, and she also spoke some French. And maybe I'm not always sure why. She would never really explain why. But she was a very literate woman, college graduate, first social worker. And one of the seminal experiences that I had with her is that one day at school, I was called a name that I didn't appreciate, and I struggled with what my identity was in this kind of divided city. Now, I left school, I came home, I was crying on the sofa. She didn't say anything, she let me settle down, and I told them what they called me. I said, Grandma, they called me this. Baba, they called me this. She says, it's not what they call you, it's what you answer to. And that has been a very powerful thing. And I think that's very powerful for us in pediatric surgery. And she did everything she could to kind of make this man child this kind of really strong person. And I pulled this from the help because, you know, what she would do to me at times was every morning she'd have me stand in the mirror and she'd say, I am smart, I am beautiful, and I can change the world. I am smart, I am beautiful, I can change the world. When one you love tells you that nonsense, what happens this morning? I stand in the mirror and I say, I'm smart, I'm not, I'm beautiful, I'm not, but I still feel I can change the world. And so it was this wisdom, this from the ancestors, as she would say, that really changed my perspective for a lifetime. She also said to me, in this time where we didn't necessarily see all the possibilities for our life, this quote that has become a mantra for me, that nothing splendid in life has ever been achieved except by those who dare believe that something inside of them was superior to circumstance, but not superior to people. And so this type of mantra that she also had given my father in 1961, my parents, no money, no stature in our community, decided that they wanted a life better for their children than they had for themselves. And they sued the public school system. They lost the case. 4 people dropped out of the case. It was only another couple. They went to the state Supreme Court. And at the beginning of 1962, they won this case. Now, my parents, as you see here, if you think of Martin Luther King as being the general, they were the foot soldiers in the army. And we won the case. And in fact, 4 months after the case was won and my sister was suffering under the weight of the pressures and people were teasing, threatening to shoot her with Clorox, people were threatening to blow up our house, some guy comes to our house, my mother's all giddy and excited, he's talking with his hands, and as a 3.5-year-old, I'm looking at this guy and think that he looks like any other African-American preacher. Little did I know until a few years later that was Martin Luther King who had come to our house. And that gave the energy for us to move forward. And I always asked my dad, why did we do this? Why did you do this? And he said that love was the motive, but justice was the tool. Didn't realize that was Reinhold Niebuhr. But this became our civic duty and social responsibility. And this is the noblesse oblige. This is what my grandmother talked about all the time. This French thing, noblesse oblige. And I thought she was making it up until I got to Yale. And I took a classics course and they had Homer's Iliad. And Kagan, when he talked about this course, talked about this this whole concept of civic duty and responsibility that evolved into Western civilization when Honoré de Balzac, I'm sorry, Henri, my French isn't good, in his Lilies of the Valley and the Letter to a Young Man, wrote about the importance of service obligation for those who had nobility. And it was incorporated in the French dictionary about that time in the mid-1800s, that whoever is noble must conduct himself accordingly. And that extends beyond entitlement, but it's those who hold status, they must fulfill responsibility. Noble and elite. Noble and elite. These last 2 years have been mind-blowing. Between the virus, the changes in the financial market, the racial reckoning, the female recession from the marketplace, and the loss in gender equality that occurs in the deep divisions that have happened in our country, we are at a point that Malcolm Gladwell would call, in many ways, a tipping point. That is when small things may make a big difference, and we have an opportunity to do those small things that make a big difference. So when we look at what we do in healthcare, and what the pandemic did is that the pandemic laid bare the systemic inequities that exist in this country that lead to poor health outcomes. And all of us, not to any fault, we work in this area here, healthcare. We're doing all the fancy things, but that's only 20% of the overall health outcomes. We are, in many ways, forgetting, maybe even neglecting, those components that are related to the zip code or the lived environment. And in many ways, I think we as physicians have a tremendous opportunity and obligation to work in this quadrant. These are the so-called social determinants of health. And there is a conceptual framework that I won't go through that helps explain how these are interrelated. But you'll see there are physician factors that can impact these. I honor my ancestors and I honor my friends. This picture was taken at this meeting 4 years ago when Henri was president. And Paul has been a friend since I was an intern and he was a medical student. And you know, he talked to me at that time and had talked to me before when I was speaking with him and Diana Farmer in Philadelphia about this concept that as we get more and more molecular in our approach, that in some ways there is a certain desocialization in the level of our academic inquiry. And what we need to do is to create biosocial understandings of medical phenomena. Those are urgently needed. So who are we as pediatric surgeons at this time as we face the next 50 years? Who do we answer to? What are we called to be? And I ask you rhetorically, do we have a social responsibility? And what is social responsibility? I think it's the professional duty to think about the health of society in a more holistic way. And we can do this through a variety of ways. And I want to offer to you, this isn't Ed Barksdale pushing you to say you got to be an advocate or an activist, but there are many ways, whether it's through your leadership, whether it's your individual practice, your engagement, that we have, in my opinion, an obligation to improve society in addition to the work that we do. Well, some people say, Ed, you're wrong. And there's a lot written on it that doctors should stay in their lane, and that if we delve in these areas, we will be less good, if that's the way to say that we won't do our craft well. And in fact, less than 50% of surgeons in the last 3 years, according to the bulletin, have been involved in any form of advocacy. And even fewer percentage of surgeons vote. So what about this concept of surgeon as advocate? Is this something we buy? Well, you know, when I put this talk together, I didn't really look at the agenda of this meeting. What a meeting this has been. What a meeting. Lots of power. I planned the speakers, but I didn't look at the abstracts. And so I think that we do have a responsibility to be advocates. So what, you know, where does this come from? Most of us will know this guy if we don't know him by his appearance. This is Rudolf Virchow, and he's the father of modern pathology. But he's also the father of social medicine. And in the mid-1800s, He said that physicians are the natural advocates of the poor. And not many people bought into that, but he began to set the tone for this concept of advocacy. So what is advocacy? There's a wide variety of components, but you can see here it's a variety of things that can be done to promote promote changes that improve the health and well-being of patients. You can speak up, you can collaborate with others, you can build support and do a variety of things that, as an end goal, have an impact. And those things are things that are intentional. But we here stay in our lane. But this young surgeon, this young leader in pediatric surgery, Heather Leiby, with her mentor, Catherine Hunter, challenged this by asking this question. And I hope you'll get a chance to meet Heather. I didn't know she was wanted to be a pediatric surgeon until she said hello to me a couple days ago. And so she did this study in which she looked at 3 academic medical centers across the country, 123 respondents, 72% said yes. But interestingly, there is a gender difference in that. So the female surgeons, 86%, almost 9 in 10, were very much into social justice advocacy. These are the reasons, however, that people say, no, I can't do it. Just their personal choice, I respect. A feeling that it's not in line with professionalism, I respect that. And their concerns about their relationships with their patients. But the good news is that 72% of people who responded said yes. How about our national, regional, local surgical society? Should we be involved in this advocacy and activism? Well, when we look at the pillars for APSA, when I look at them, advocacy, maybe not activism, is deeply embedded in everything that we do in APSA. And I think that's good because we take care of children and their families. We take care of the vulnerable. And I think that's great. And I applaud the work that's been done in advocacy. These are the kind of top areas, and you guys know this this work better than I do. So there's a major opioid crisis. Why should we be concerned about opioids? Well, our colleagues here have published 1 of 2 of the papers. And interestingly enough, this type of advocacy, so this doesn't involve any form of activism, confronting anyone, but this type of advocacy leads to change in behaviors. And you can see this was picked up by the New York Times and all the media, and is making a big difference. So for me, it's changed my prescribing habits. And I know, having had one of my son's friends who had a shoulder injury become addicted to heroin and then ultimately have an overdose. So this is a big deal. How about firearms? So this august group also looked at firearms and has written position papers and statements. And recently, not a political endorsement, we made an endorsement of someone who espouses the views that are consistent with our organization. The area, though, that I find that's probably most controversial to you is this concept of the surgeon as an activist. And, you know, when you look at the definitions for activism, it kind of says people chained to the fence, people kind of yelling with speakers. I can't imagine that being us, but there are other ways of being active in supporting a variety of causes, and we've seen that within our group. I like to think of activism, you probably recognize I'm a Reinhold Niebuhr fan, that I think of it as, and it's what we do, that we comfort the afflicted and that we afflict the comfortable. Or as John Lewis would say, that we become good trouble. Again, we comfort and then we afflict those who are too comfortable and don't listen. So these are the dichotomy between advocacy and activism. Too many words for someone like me with some adult ADD, but you get it. Advocacy is a bit like listening and educating, and activism is doing. So someone says, Ed, you know, someone said, I can't understand this activism thing. I know your parents did that, but my parents never yelled and screamed. My parents just showed up. And they wrote things and they prepared. They were nonviolent. And this is a way we can do activism. We can tweet We can tweet our opinion. So the NRA said, stay in our lane. And we had many people say, no, this is our lane. And that's a part of both advocacy and activism. We're educating and informing as well as making a statement. Few would argue that this woman is not an activist. I don't even have to say her name. We all know her. And so what is a pediatric surgeon doing, sticking a swab up someone's nose? She should be doing hernias or Wilms tumors. But the reality is that she saw a condition that had much greater impact on the humanity of this country, on the health outcomes. And she took her skill sets and her passion as an activist trained as a pediatric surgeon and moved from activism, advocacy activism, to a type of leadership and now has an important role. So for me, for Ed Barksdale, I see that the crux, the transition, the overlap for advocacy and activism sits in this realm. And this is leadership. And in fact, I like calling this not just simple leadership, but boundary spanning leadership. And this is a concept, actually, my father talked about this, but I think CCL kind of owns this concept in term. But boundary spanning leadership is the capacity to lead across domains, vertically, horizontally, across ethnicities, diverse groups and stakeholders in order to establish a direction, an alignment, and a commitment. And I think one of the things that has challenged us as surgeons is the staying in our lane, staying in our sphere. And those of us who are beginning to have tremendous impact are recognizing this importance to step outside the hospital, the operating room, and to step in our communities, to step into the floors of Congress in order to move forward the agenda of things that are important to children and families and life in this country. A term that's become popular that you know is allyship, and I think that this boundary-spanning leadership and allyship are akin to each other. This is, I prefer, a career-long process of collaborating and building relationships that create a flat landscape or hierarchy so that when you show up as a physician, you're not necessarily Dr. Barksdale, you're Ed, who's here to work with gang members on gun violence or with community people on food deserts, so that it allows people to feel you as being approachable. Again, this adult ADD steps in. I like infographics because I can think better in terms of pictures. You can do this at an individual level. So I'm not challenging you to take gigantic steps. You can do small things. You can give care that's individualized. Think about the social determinants as they affect food insecurities, housing instability that may impact your patients, transportation. But you can also think, as these leaders in APSA and their communities have, at the institutional level. And I hope these individuals are all familiar to you and the work that they're doing, which really shines a bright halo on us in APSA. And then there are those in our group who are doing things at a much more structural level. I hope you know them as well, and if you don't know them, I hope you get to know them and get to connect with their work. So I like this statement from Harvard Business Review that calls an ally as a collaborator, an accomplice, or a conspirator. But for me, being an ally means, my word, being a co-inspirator, someone who is working to inspire someone else who is inspiring them. And so that it becomes good. And there is a co-inspirator in the room, or maybe he's gone, but I try not to use the names, but Pete Masiakos, like my kids say, you're fire. I mean, you inspire the governor, you inspire me, I don't know where you get the energy. And so this is the concept. And so we don't have to emulate anyone in our group, but we can use the work that people do that are making an impact outside of the operating room. So for me, allyship equals boundary spanning leadership. We'll move on. This is the area that I'd like to move into of kind of my work. I got to Cleveland in 2007, and I never realized that we had a public health crisis and violence. Pittsburgh wasn't that way. And if you don't think that there's a violence epidemic, then you must be living under a rock at this time. If you look at what's in the news and the statistics, it is awful. And in a place like Cleveland, where the numbers are really high, we've had a tremendous spike in the gun violence rate. And you can see across the country in the major cities, it's up 47% in 2020 during the pandemic. In fact, it is not just, violence is not just epidemic, and we're not just living in a pandemic. We are living, in my opinion, in a syndemic. A syndemic is when there's a synergistic epidemic, as described here, when two things aggregate together that amplify the adverse impact of them. And so we must, as pediatric surgeons, as Ed Barksdale says, think about how we fight the syndemic. We've seen this just a few weeks ago in the New England Journal of Medicine paper, which I think is distressing, but is, again, a part of the call to action. Look at the numbers. Gun violence, both suicide, fire, and homicide, are now the leading cause of death in children. Never imagined I'd see that in my lifetime. Never imagined. But I came to understand that in 2007 when I moved to Cleveland to take my dream job, chief of surgery at a major children's hospital. And people will say, no, I didn't ever think about being this. I always wanted to work in a leadership role. I won't deny it. I worked quietly. But that dream was shattered by a bullet. And in fact, my first patient at Rainbow was a kid who died from a gunshot wound, who looked like my oldest son. He was a year older. My son who's graduating from Case Medical School tomorrow. And these are all the things about Cleveland. You can see this, you know. School district with the highest suicide rate, city of despair, highest infant mortality of any city in the United States. This was my dream job. And when I got there, I realized that the challenge wasn't to try to get back to the lab to make tumor vaccines, but to think more holistically about the community. And this was my first patient. His mother gives me permission to use his picture and to tell his story. Brandon was on his way to his aunt's house to play a video game, and he didn't have something in Cleveland that's called a hood pass, which means if you go through certain neighborhoods, you gotta have a pass that allows you to go through that neighborhood. He was shot and killed, shot in his femoral artery. And even today, 15 years later, 14 and a half years later, there's a ribbon out in front, ribbon on the tree in front of his house, and teddy bears and stuffed animals were placed. She still thinks he's gonna come through the door. She came to my endowed chair ceremony 2 years after I got there, and she gave a powerful commentary. I don't even think she was invited, but I think it even impacted my children who weren't thinking about medicine to pursue medicine. So again, when I got to Cleveland, as much as I tried to tightrope my way back toward academic medicine, I got pulled back into these social determinants. And as Brian Stevenson said to us yesterday, I realized that if I was gonna have an impact, you know, this grandmother talking to me in my ear, you know, you can change the world. If I was gonna have any form of impact, I'd have to get proximate to the problem. I'd have to get into uncomfortable places. And this was before I knew of Brian Stevenson. So I was outraged. I went to the president of the hospital. He sent me to meet the chief of police, and we met the mayor, and we established the program Operation Focus, which was a tough violence prevention program. We called these young kids under 18 in who had done violent things. We brought them in. We went into crack houses, the juvenile detention center. I went to street corners. I had met with these gang members who had done some horrendous things. In the process of getting close to them, I came to understand them. And in the process of coming to understand them, in our program, we were able to cut the murder rate in Cleveland to the 50-year low in 2010. And then we parlayed this into a $2 million grant with Steve Dettelbach. And you can see here that Attorney General Holder came to meet with Steve and I when they gave us the $2 million grant. And so what happened when the money ran out? The violence rate went back up again. But I pulled this article, which is interesting, from 2011 when I spoke to the media. I said, it says here, he said those involved in the efforts have no obligation, something, but not only to save lives, but to save whole lifetimes. Something familiar, right? That's how I think we think. So what I learned by going into the community, by getting proximate, I learned what was in the soil. I learned that violence was not about the guns, the gun manufacturers. I learned that it was about this thing I like, the terroir. I can't say that well on me either, but when you, those of you who like wine will know that it's what's in the soil, what's in the climate. And I recognized that we would have to go deep in order to change problems. And the roots of violence were not the things that we thought. We were not going to arrest our way out of the violence epidemic. We were going to have to do something different. When I looked at these same neighborhoods that were redline neighborhoods like the one I grew up in, were the areas where the infant mortality was the highest, where the poverty was the highest, where the sexual assault, where the murder rates were high, where the kidney failure rates were the highest. And so that there was something in the soil. When I went to the schools, when I read to first graders and talked with them, I realized that in places like urban Cleveland, childhood is blurred. And for some children, it's almost as though there are no children here. I went to the funeral of one of my patient's brothers who was shot recently, and someone said at least he got to 24 years of age. Well, that's unacceptable. My dreams were just really maturing at that time. But as I met these kids, I realized that many of them had witnessed things in their home and in their community that not just changed the way they cognitively processed things or saw the world, but it changed their it changed their physiology. And in fact, as a result of kind of changing their physiology, some things that occurred with them changed their blood pressure, changed their sugar, and so that the body kept score, even if it seemed as though they were doing okay. So I realized that trauma and violence were at the root of a lot of the health issues, and that many of the patients that I saw, even though we look at the outcomes as death, disability, and disease, it was despair that really had a tremendous impact on their outcomes. But the other thing that was more distressing to me is a different type of violence that I witnessed, and I am concerned, I'm hoping that we will not commit that same violence as pediatric surgeons. And that's the violence of indifference. And that's the structural violence. And those of you who understand the concept from Johann Galtung of structural violence is that that's the type of violence that's deeply embedded in our social structures. And it's the one that's often out of the control of individuals. Paul Farmer has popularized this in our understanding, and because it is beyond our patient's control, it puts them at risk, but it's still actionable, and we have an opportunity to impact that. So I moved my focus away from the guns, the vector, to the victim. And I recognized that many of the children I was seeing were children who were fractured, living in chaotic neighborhoods. And once I understood that they were hurt, I recognized and I got an understanding of this quote that hurt people. And so what are we? We are healers. Many of us do trauma. And so once I got a good understanding of this in our patients, I realized we needed to change the language of violence, how we think about them. These aren't people with moral deficiency. They're suffering and they need to be healed despite their zip code or their circumstance. And once I got my arms around this and I thought of myself as a healer, I realized that healed people heal people. And so I decided instead of working downstream, pulling people out of the water who had been shot, taking them up, treating them, which is kind of a mantra that occurs, that I wanted to gradually go upstream. I wanted to move toward a more individual impact and then a community impact. I wanted to invest upstream in our efforts and in our time. And so we developed this program, we founded this program with a medical student called the Anti-Fragility Initiative. And what this is, as I'll go through quickly as I'm running short on time, this is a human-centered design approach to establishing a social innovation program. So what we did is I took all the moleskins that I had from the notes I'd made, from the circumstances I'd seen, the empathy I'd gained from being in the community. I tried to define the problem. I told people I got skinny in thinking how could we do one thing that might be helpful. And then we created ideas, we built a prototype of the program, and it's an iterative program. And this was done about 4 years ago, and it's based on the concept, the business concept of anti-fragility, and that concept is that companies that go through chaos are actually stronger, made stronger by disorder. But I also liked this concept of the Japanese art form, kintsugi, and some of you may be familiar with this. So this is a pot that a Japanese shogun had. It was broken, his favorite teapot. He went all around the country, no one could fix it, but one artisan filled the broken spaces with gold. And as a result of putting the gold in the interstices, it made the pot more valuable. And we had this idea, maybe we could do this with children. So we built this program, Anti-Fragility. These are our core values. You can see the things about it online. Community equity, prevention, opportunity, and care. But built on the concept that we could create post-traumatic growth. We wanted to keep them from getting shot again. 30% of the children ages 7 to 15 who get shot to come in, shot and come into Rainbow will come back in 2 years shot again, and then 30% will come back with a suicide attempt or major depression. So we wanted to impact this. Hospital-based program, but health care occurs in the hospital, health occurs in the community. So we see them in the hospital, and I'll go through this. We engage at the bedside in what I call the teachable moment. That is the golden hour in which we have an opportunity to intervene in their life. And in within 24 hours of discharge, our social workers are in their home. We aim to find their strengths. We want to know what they like, what they want to do, and we try to be purveyors of hope, to give them a sense of possibility. And we're not perfect. We've seen about 300 children and families. We collaborate with various agencies in the city, but the most important collaboration we have, which I think is important in advocacy, is with the Mandel School, which is a big database, one of the six big databases in the country. They have every child born in Cuyahoga County from 1989 to the present, 250 million entries across 35 domains, and 93% of our patients. We did a study with 400 patients over a two-year period of time. 93% of those are in the database. We can tell you when their mother got her first GYN appointment when she was a kid, when she was first pregnant, if they were food insecure, and as a result, we've been able to create a profile using this of who's at risk. And the goal of our program is to create a mathematical model of a child who's born today in Cleveland, what the likelihood that he or she will be shot or victimized. And we find that the average age of the gunshot wound in Cleveland is 12.9 years. And so we want to change that. We have a very conservative governor in the state of Ohio. And I tried to get in front of him to tell him this story, to get him to fund us. And he said, I don't have time to talk to you. He kept walking. Doctor, I don't have time to talk to you. He kept walking. His security people came in. I kept talking. And 45 minutes later, Michael DeWine was speaking to me, and he said, Doc, if you put that on paper, I'm going to fund it. And so we got it on paper. He gave us just under $700,000 and announced that he felt we had the most socially innovative program that he had seen. And the rest is history. We've had $2.5 million in funding since then. So as I close, I say to you, it's not what they call you. It's not what they call us as pediatric surgeons. It's what we answer to. So what are we going to answer to individually or collectively? I know when I look in this room, you are the best in the world. There's so many of you who are the best in the world, and those of you who are about to be the best in the world. But might I ask you, could you be the best for the world? Subtle but important difference. So our call to action, as I close, is for us to remember that we're going to stay in our lane, but humanity is our highway. And there are multiple lanes that get us to the horizon, whether it's in the laboratory or in the community laboratory. And I think in order to do this effectively, that we have to lean in. And I've listed these things, and for time that we're over, I think that we have to be intentional. We have to think about innovating, using human-centered design approach like we did in our anti-fragility program. We want to continuously, dynamically educate ourselves as to how we can be better for our patients, even just in the office. We don't have to set up big programs, but we have to think about the lived environment and how it affects them. We have to collaborate across boundaries, boundary-spanning leadership. Think, when you leave this meeting, who can I touch base with outside of surgery, outside of the hospital, to help impact something that I'm doing in surgery? And we have to build robust research infrastructure so that we can ask critical questions. And I ask APSA for us to support through advocacy and advocacy the development of getting good science in there, that we can support early stage research programs that will get things off the ground so people can get better, so that we can think about being iterative. We've got to establish rigor. So as we get out of our comfort zone, I hope that we remember that there is very much a fierce urgency of now. And no one in this country, in my opinion, is better positioned to bring us from chaos to community than you. And so I hope that we have in this audience leaders who care enough, know enough, and do enough, who will persevere to help us make a dent in this, so that we're not just working against disease, that we're working for justice. This is what they call black boy joy. I am so excited, like this little boy in Uganda holding this cabbage. Thank you, thank you, thank you for the opportunity of a lifetime. My mother is speaking through me. My father is smiling, telling her that he's taking as much credit. But I say to you, thank you for this opportunity. And I say in closing, I'm so sorry that we can't party with you tonight. We brought our best party clothes for the event this evening. Thank you so much.